5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. They would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to noticing its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sure.
Deal.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jevning. Let's start the show.
I don't know what your personal opinion about Bigfoot is, but no joke, it exists. I'll tell my story and you come to your own conclusions. Certainly, I had the unique privilege, and it was a distinct privilege, and very fortunate to work with the Smoky Mountain National Park. I went with the School of the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. And, you know, I did it for college credit, didn't get paid for it, and the rangers kind of used us young legs and backs to do some work around the park, and the price was right because it cost them nothing, and we got certain privileges and certain things to do, you know, certain accesses to the park. It was really neat, you know, the Jeep trails and things whenever the rangers needed us to go on a search and rescue or something along that effect. They trained us in the use of the radios, and, you know, it was just kind of a big boy kind of thing to do, and really cool for a college kid. I loved it. We backpacked hundreds of miles, and I know that park like the back of my hand, and it's such beautiful country. If you've never been, definitely go. On this particular event, the rangers called in a bunch of us young guys because they needed some legs on the ground. There was a search and rescue going on. A man and his son had, when you go to the park, you backpack, you get a backcountry pass, which basically lets the rangers know where you're going to be. So in case you come up missing or anything happens, then they can send in people to help you out. And so that's why they do that, that backcountry permit thing. This one particular gentleman had filled out his backcountry permit. We knew that he was supposed to be on Mount Leconte with his son. And Mount Leconte's one of the taller mountains in the Smokies. I think it's shorter than Clingman's Dome by just a few feet. This particular mountain is isolated, and there's only one way to get there, and that's backpack a minimum of 6 miles, and you have to go up some trails a couple of thousand feet, so I believe that's right. But it's a long hike, and it's hard hike. We had a very unusual heavy snow. I mean, the mountains do get a lot of snow, but this one was quite the whopper, and it was unexpected. So this man and his son, they didn't come out of the park when they were supposed to, and they didn't go home when they were supposed to, and so the man's wife was quite concerned, contacted the park, and then we started backpacking and looking for them to go, you know, fearing the worst, that they were hypothermic or something like that, because if you've ever been to the Smokies, whenever the weather turns, it turns quickly, and it's pretty crazy. It's very cool how that happens. But you have to be prepared. Even when the day's warm, it can turn up in snow just in an hour's time. So, heavy snowfall. We're called in. I think there was six of us in our party, six young college kids. Three of us took one trail, the Allen K Trail up Mount Leconte, and the other one, which is I took, went to Mount Leconte via the Boulevard Trail. And so our idea was that by covering as many trails as we could with the number of people we had in the snow, that in these two trails are the most popular, then certainly we would encounter this man and his son along the trail if they were stuck somewhere, and we could call in the rangers and they could helicopter them out if they needed it or get them some type of emergency assistance. So we hiked all day long in the snow, and I mean, my hike I think it was about 9 miles that day. Exceedingly hard hike because I had lots of winter gear, very heavy pack, extra boots even, you know, we're just ready because we knew we were going to get wet, crampons and all those good things for the ice on the trail. And it's just a hard day's hike. I just remember, you know, the snow was up to my knees, and you know, I knew where the trail was. You could pretty well easily see where the trail was just by the indentation on the trees and, you know, on the ledges. I was familiar with the trail anyway, so it's no big deal. But just a long, hard day. And, man, to make a long story short, on arrival, we didn't see the father of the son. We didn't see any sign of them falling off the mountains. We saw no trails off that. We broke fresh snow all day long. And I still don't know what happened to the man and the son. I think they ultimately they had changed their plans and didn't tell anybody, something like that. They were fine. Nobody died. But after we hiked all day long to get up to the top of Mount Leconte, one thing about this mountain is, you know, it is, there's a small cabin that the rangers have up there for trail maintenance people and guys just like us, you know, that were helping the park and the rangers themselves, because it is such a hard hike to get up there. If you want to do any kind of substantial work, well, you need a place to rest in relative comfort, if you will. So this little cabin, it was about the size of probably about a one-car garage, I'd say. Maybe a little smaller than that. It's quite confined, low ceiling. And I had a oil burning stove, and I specifically remember a heavy door on it with a latch and lock and all those good things. Screens over the windows to keep the bears out of the cabin, but just this cozy little workers' cabin. Within the cabin there were, I believe this is correct, that there were six bunks. I think three high on each side. That's important that you remember that, because so you got this little cabin, six bunks up the walls on each side of the cabin, oil stove, and that's all that's in this cabin. After finished hiking the day, we had our meals. We cooked up some things on our Whisper Light, had a nice hot meal, and had some hot beverages. We did not consume alcohol that night. I remember, because we were too tired to even bother getting drunk. We did have alcohol, just for full disclosure. We didn't drink any of it. We were not on drugs. We did not smoke any dope or anything like that. It's important that you know that. We were just fatigued and so tired. We were so glad to get warm in the cabin, get some of our clothes drying out again, and just really glad that the day was over with. After finishing our meal, we hit the racks, and the temperature that night, I think, got down to about 2 degrees. Wind was howling outside. Wind was blowing across the mountain, as it all normally does. And it was just really, really cool, beautiful night. I just like those nights when you're in the woods and the weather's active and winds blowing and snowing, and snowed some more that night. Not a whole lot, but just, you know, kind of dusting on top of what was already there. But it was, stars were out, beautiful night. So we We radioed to the rangers, told them where we were, told them, gave them a status update, and ate our meal, and we got into our sleeping bags. And so we all had these, you know, 0-degree sleeping bags or minus 10 sleeping bags where you zip up. They're all mummy style. You know, they wrap over your head. And basically all you've got is your eyes sticking out if you've got it on correctly. And you can actually sleep in the buff in these things, and they actually work better that way against your body, and they keep you very warm. So we're all in our mummy bags. We're all zipped up. The door's locked. We've got our stuff ready for breakfast the next morning, you know, just taking care of our business. And, man, let's just get some sleep. I'm so ready to go sleep. I'm so tired. My bones are achy. I got a little bit of a headache from all the work. I'm just so ready to go to sleep. So we finally, one by one, I just remember there wasn't a lot of clowning around that night. Us guys, we got into our sleeping bag, zipped up, and out we went. Then, I don't know how long we were asleep, but something started howling and screaming outside of that cabin. It was horrible. It was horrific. It sounded something very similar to this. Oh, dear God. I woke up. And something was screaming on the outside of this cabin. And it wasn't screaming a little. It was screaming a lot. Then, the something started beating on the side of this cabin. I have a lot of experience with black bears. Black bears, you know, they climb, they scratch, they'll pat and they'll hit. But they don't hit like this thing was hitting the side of this cabin. The door, I specifically remember the door flexing on the very top of the door, flexing in as this thing, whatever it was pounding on the outside of the door. I'm looking out of my mummy bag to my buddy who's directly across in another bunk. I think I was on the third bunk high, looking across, and he's looking at me. And you think, here's where it's interesting for me. You think that, you know, six tough former football players in shape, full of, you know, manhood, testosterone, we can do anything. You think those guys like that, we would zip that sleeping bag and, you know, grabbed our weapons and let's, you know, kick its ass, whatever it is, you know. If it breaks that door and I'm killing it, oh, no. When you have true fear, you freeze. You freeze. I remember the distinct feeling of being so helpless in that sleeping bag and knowing that if whatever it was that was beating on that door came inside, that it was just going to kill us. Because I couldn't even vocalize to my friends anything. In fact, all of us were awake. All of us were looking at each other. None of us said a word, and none of us moved. I found that fascinating, but I still remember that fear. This thing was raising hell outside of our cabin. And the beating on the door, I specifically remember just kind of like a rumbling, just like, and then it was gone. The cabin returned to stone cold silence. Nobody said a word. Somehow, I remember going back to sleep. And I'm sure we were just so tired and fatigued, we all just kind of, I guess one by one, went back to sleep. We woke up the next morning, unzipped our bags, put our clothes on, you know, got all of our warm stuff on, ready to hike out and head on back to Knoxville, back to college. We opened up, nobody saying a word. We make breakfast, we're all packing very quickly, all six of those guys. We normally would goof around, you know, have some coffee, whatever. This morning is very different. We're all just very businesslike, and the only thing we were talking about is, you know, hey, John, you left your bag unzipped or whatever, zip it up. And we're just very businesslike, getting it done. We get back on the trail. We walk just outside the cabin door, and there's tracks. And there's big tracks. By that time, you know, the wind, it had been a windy night. There was just these big indentions in the snow. There wasn't anything specific as far as counting toes. I'm not going to lie to you, but there was these big impressions outside that cabin door in the snow. And of course, the snow and the new snow had fallen had wiped them out, which I was really glad that I did not see distinct impressions, by the way. At that moment, I just couldn't handle it. But they were there. So we know that nobody was on Mount McCoff at lunch because the weather was so bad. We know because we work with the park rangers. We knew where they all were. By the pure reason that it was so cold and Mount McCoff so hard to get to and the conditions were so inhospitable that night, there's no way this was a practical joker at all. Nobody would, I mean, whoever would do that would be completely insane. But what I heard wasn't human. What I found pounding, what I heard pounding on the door, that can be done by a man to flex that door that high up. So we get our stuff on. We're hiking out, and we're moving at a good pace. Nobody's talking. We hiked about 2 miles down off the mountain. The sun was up, you know, high in the sky now. We started to feel a little comfortable, I guess. But we had not spoken much at all until we stopped and everybody took their packs off and sit down. And I specifically remember one of my buddies going, "Okay, guys, now what the hell was that last night?" And we all said, looked at each other and said, "I don't know." That's all that we talked about. We put our packs back on, and we could not wait to get back home. Nope, we didn't tell any rangers that night because, quite frankly, they would have thought we were smoking dope or something, and nobody would believe us anyway. Well, I'm telling you, in my mind and heart, Bigfoot absolutely exists. Absolutely exists. People say, "Well, why didn't you find the body?" Well, if you've ever spent any time in the backcountry at all, you know there's bears out there, but yet you never find a bear bone. You know there's deer out there, and you will find deer bones occasionally, a jawbone or something like that. But even those bones disappear pretty quickly. Nature cleans up after itself. I see absolutely no reason why Bigfoot doesn't exist. But I will, to the day I die, remember the fear, the paralyzing fear that came over me and 5 other big strapping dudes that night on Mount Leconte in the Smoky Mountains. Bigfoot is real. I never, ever want to hear that sound again. Never, ever, ever.
That was Tim Hall doing his recounting his Bigfoot story. But before we get into the encounter, happy Thanksgiving, guys.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Yes, yes, to you all too.
Did you guys get your fill of turkey?
I probably had more than I probably should have. Yeah. I think I had 2 Thanksgivings, actually. You know, most people do, I guess.
Yeah, one at the bar and one with family.
Come on now. That's supposed to
stay on you.
So what did you guys think of that encounter?
I thought we had a code of silence on that, and here we are, you know, on live radio telling everyone, what the heck, man?
Yeah, yeah. So what did you guys think of that encounter?
I really liked it. Yeah, go ahead, Will.
No, I was just going to say it was fascinating. It's very reminiscent of the, you know, the 1924 miners attack at Mount St. Helens.
Wes and I were just watching that yesterday, Wes. That's funny that you brought that up, Will. It does remind me a lot of that. I think one of the best things that I enjoyed out of that whole listening to that video is when they're in their bunks and you're talking about men that are, you know, football players and they're big guys, and it kind of makes me reminisce of when Wes and I had our encounter, because we did nothing other than kind of sit there and, you know, maybe say a prayer. And that's kind of what these guys did. So, you know, I kind of enjoyed that part of it.
Yeah, it's funny how fear can come over people like that, especially, you know, you kind of know what's out there. And in that part of the country, you know, bears aren't particularly big and there's only black bears. So, you know, it kind of narrows down the possibilities of what could be out there screaming like that and then, you know, trying to get into a pretty well-built cabin against six grown men.
Yeah, it made me think when I first heard it of intention, you know, what was its intention? Screaming, it's bending those doors. And anyone who knows those cabins, when they build those cabins up there, they build them with the intent to stand for a long time and take a beating because, you know, rarely do they get up there to do any maintenance on those type of cabins. And
right.
It really made me think of the intention. You know, it seemed like it was trying to get in. A lot of people think, well, if it wanted to get in, it could have gotten in. But I don't know that's the case in this situation. I think it tried to, and it couldn't get in, and it was pissed.
Yeah, I think you're right there. Well, first of all, you know, as I was listening to it, I was thinking of the different components of intention, like you brought up. You know, obviously, number one, it knew that these men had come into the cabin, so it was watching them previous to this time. The screaming tells me that it wasn't screaming in rage. It was screaming, probably alerting its friends, saying, hey, you know, we got a meal up here. And then, of course, trying to get in the cabin. And you're right, those cabins are built to withstand extreme winter weather and conditions. So they're very difficult to get into.
Yeah, I wonder what would have happened if they would have stepped out to challenge what was out there. Those six guys would have stepped out to challenge if it would have ran off, or maybe, you know, the other regarding intention, I wonder if it was trying to figure out how well armed are these guys, how well, you know, if I go up banging on the cabin and these guys and start shooting, what are we dealing with here?
Yeah, that could have been the dominant individual going up to make the challenge.
Yeah, scary nonetheless. I know a lot of people wanted us to discuss Bigfoot migration habits, but I had another encounter I wanted to play for you guys, get your guys' take on it, being that it's, you know, Thanksgiving, not a lot of shows are on right now. I thought it'd be kind of, you know, most people want to hear about encounters. Now, on this next one, I can't do anything about the sound effects. Somebody else added the sound effects. It wasn't me. But I found the encounter fascinating. Take a listen to this one. Tell me what you guys think of this one.
My husband and I moved to Louisiana with Brown and Root Construction. We lived in a little house in the middle of nowhere. There was swamps behind our house and big corn stalks growing in sand. And he got up very early, and he was off to work around 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. And I had a German Shepherd puppy. And he said, please, whatever you do, go in the house when I leave for work tomorrow. And I said, why? And he said, because I had an encounter this morning with something on the way to work. And I said, what? He said, I think it was a bear. And I was on my motorcycle, and the bear didn't move. And I said, well, a bear is scared of sound. It would have ran. He said, well, I don't know what it was, but I hiked my motorcycle up fast as it would go and went under its arm, kind of sideways on the motorcycle, and it scratched all up my back. And he was white as a ghost, so I knew he told me the truth. So I said, okay, so I'm sitting on my porch, and I'm drinking my coffee about 4:30 in the morning, and we burned our garbage in a big barrel behind the house, and I heard this noise. So I went back there with the dog to check to see what it was. And it was humongous. It had to be 9 foot tall. Brown hair just swaying in the, it was moonlight. And I didn't know what to do. I just froze. And the dog started barking trying to go to it. The dog was on a leash. And I said, come on dog, we're going back in the house. And the thing come up out of getting the garbage out of the can and screamed this awful bloody scream. His eyes had to be that big. It was the scariest thing I think I've ever encountered. And I thought it was going to get me, so I ran in the house. Then I realized we had an attic fan Every window in my house was open. Checked on my kids. They were fine. Went to my bedroom. I had just got my phone the day before. And Ronnie had guns. He always had guns. So I laid the gun, the shotgun, on my bed. And I picked the phone up, and my friend lived 12 miles from the house. And I called her, and I said, you need to get up here. There's something outside my window walking back and forth, and all I can see is legs with hair just waving in the wind. And she said, okay, I'll be right there. Well, when she pulled up in her van, I guess it was loud, the thing went away. And I actually thought it was going to come in and kill me. I didn't know what it was going to do. So, I wasn't too upset because it had left. And she stayed with me all day. Well, later in the day, I had my TV on. And it said they had spotted Sasquatch. And it was right behind my house where they had spotted it. So when Ronnie came in from work, I said, screw it, living here. I'm moving back to Arkansas. I'm not living with boogers. I'm just not. Because they had rats. Well, that was what I called it. They had rats as big as dogs there. I saw one. Its teeth were that long. And it was sitting out in the chicken house, but there wasn't any chickens in the yard. No wonder it wouldn't have survived. But that was my encounter. And the scratches on his back, I knew he didn't lie about it because he's not scared of anything. And he said, okay, let's go back. And I wouldn't wish that on anybody. I don't know that it was going to hurt me, but I don't know that it wasn't. I just know had it tried to come in that window, I would have shot it. Or had a heart attack one, but probably shot it.
So what part of Louisiana was this?
It was in northern Louisiana in a place called Hall Summit, which is right outside of Cushato. And he worked in Shreveport, so he had to drive through the swamp to get to work. Well, it was, he was non-union. They had unions. They burnt the bridge, so he had to go, you know, long way around. And I was just petrified because he was gone all that time, you know, working. And I was there by myself with three kids in the middle of nowhere. Yes, I had a car until that happened. And he said, I'm leaving the motorcycle, and I'm taking the car. I said, what am I supposed to do? I can't put three kids on a motorcycle and get up and go. And he said, well, you just stay in the house and keep the doors locked. That was not a fun day.
Wow.
And shortly after that, might have been a week, we moved back to Arkansas. And I know there's such a thing because I saw with my own eyes.
And didn't have a camera.
Didn't have anything.
Didn't have anything to document it.
Didn't know it was going
to
happen even.
Sure.
And my son was always going hunting out behind my house. And I put a stop to that because he was very young. He was about 9, maybe. I said, no more, because I don't know what that thing might do.
Yeah, there's not much I can do about the sound effects. I was trying to find the one without the sound effects. But the lady's encounter I thought was interesting. I mean, she lives like in the middle of nowhere. And, you know, they've seen bears. They've seen all the wildlife in that area. And it makes me wonder about what the thing's intentions were. What did you guys think about that encounter?
Well, you know, it's sort of, it's very similar to a lot of other stories I've heard from that part of the country. I'm doing some work with skunk ape researchers in that part of the country for a book, and they get some pretty creepy stories in that region.
But what is the what kind of creepy stories are you getting from that, Will?
Well, you know, the behavior. Of course, it's consistent behavior even with the Sasquatch here. You know, coming up, digging in trash, things like that. If you go back even to films like, you know, the original Legend of Boggy Creek, which really isn't geographically that far from where she lives. There were people who were mauled. There were people, you know, where the things would come up, you know, look into the windows. They would do very aggressive type behaviors. One gentleman I've been talking to, he lives in Georgia now, but he was telling me there were some stories through his research in the Carolinas, and I don't remember what time period, but where these things, or one of these things was coming, it was following the creeks around this community, and it was killing livestock and other animals just for the sheer pleasure of killing. It wasn't eating, and it was biting them, you know, through the back of their neck, you know, severing their spinal columns and doing some very grotesque things. So I seem to come across more and more of these stories with this kind of a flavor to them. So it's very interesting, and it's very similar to other things I've heard about that region.
Now, before we get into the migration habits, there's one encounter I'd like you to listen to, Will. It's one we've played on the show before. It's a guy from Texas that claims to have shot two of them. And basically, to line the story up, himself, it was he and three buddies, and they're all Vietnam War vets coming back from the war. And they had basically went out hunting. And while out hunting, they had made their money. They had made their living off of hunting. They had made their money off of, you know, bear skin, cougar skin, and also taking care of these pests that were upsetting these local farmers in the area. And he claims to have shot two of them. I'm kind of curious to see what you think about this one.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, we're using spotlights off the roof of the pickup. We're using 500-watt halogen bulbs. It would light up anything from within a half a mile. You can see where you're standing, see the ground good. The thing about it is, after you hunted as much as we did, you could tell by looking at a set of eyes what they were.
Mm-hmm.
If they were a cow, they were wide apart and they were red. If they were a coyote, they were narrow and they were more blue-red. I mean, it just, after a period of time, Art, you knew what, you could look in that scope and you knew what was there. It was just out of way. I mean, but anyway, we come around this bend and come up over this rise, and there was a wheat field out in front of us, and just before we crossed this creek, and it was a valley down in there, and it's probably, has wheat land right there, and it's probably a quarter mile or so wide to from that road to the creek. And it's probably about a mile long. It runs alongside that creek, and it's flat and has fit. And we come around this bend and up and over a little hill and dropped into this valley. Well, just as we dropped into this valley, our lights hit, picked up a set of eyes. I hit the brakes. I was driving, and Bird Dog, he come out on the side. He had a 300 Weatherby Magnum, and he come across the top. I said, "What you got?" And he says, "I don't know. That ain't something I ever seen before." Well, it just sat there. The reddest eyes I've ever seen in my life.
Really?
Under those lights.
Okay.
It was something we knew it wasn't a deer because the eyes, and I could see whatever it was crouching. Bird Dog, he got out and leaned over the hood of the pickup where you could get him a good shot. And Jim, he come up over the top of the cab, and I don't even remember what kind of, I think he was using the 270, I don't remember for sure. But he lined up over the cab, and I was sitting there, and we just had both these spotlights on this varmint there. And I said, "I don't know what it is," and they don't either. And I said, "Well, it sure ain't nothing we know about it. Let's take it." And all three of us fired at the same time. And all of a sudden, this thing got up, and it must have been 7-8 foot tall at least, I don't know. Scared the heck out of us, started running. And well, we all loaded, and we fired again. We knocked it down again. And then it run, I guess, it was probably 100, maybe 150 yards from the point we fired the first time till it hit the fence and went into that creek. And we knocked it down. It's probably 25, 30 yards from the fence. And just as it was crossing the creek, we hit it again.
Now, was it running on four legs or
it
two?
It was running on two legs, just like a human being. And I mean, it was...
Right, so it was running on two legs. It's
right.
Something you've never seen before, but you three guys cut down on it.
Well, we had done shot, and we did not know what it was. It was hunched over. It really wasn't... using its front legs, I mean its arms, as much as it was It wasn't standing up straight. We still thought it was, what I thought it was at first, to be honest with you, was a bear.
Yeah.
And that's why we fired.
You guys are all non-vets, right?
Right.
And so you've had night combat, I'm sure.
Right.
Okay, so you have something getting up on two legs and running away, and you still cut down on it. Okay, I have the picture. Go ahead, please.
Okay. But like I said, I originally thought it was a bear.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea. We had done fired on it at the point in time that it was sitting out there. And once we fired, I don't know, I guess we just got a little bit gung-ho and kept shooting. But anyway, the second time we shot it, it went over the fence. Well, we went and looked, and at this point in time, we were all getting scared because we thought, well, maybe this wasn't an animal.
Right.
So, like I say, it was probably 3, 4, 5 in the morning, so we decided to drive around a while, about 5:36. We went back over there, and we drove up there, and we went down, and we seen blood. So, we seen some tracks, looked like a human foot, and to be honest with you, I thought, well, now we done shot a human.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm getting scared. So we go on up and start following these tracks, and the creek runs from this point probably 50, 75 yards east, and then it turns back south some. Well, these tracks are going down the creek, and they come out, and they went straight on east from where the creek turned back south. About another 25, 30 yards, there was a plum thicket. And we were walking there, and we heard something in that plum thicket. I mean, it was a growl-type sound. So I got elected. I had a 44 Magnum pistol. I climbed into the plum thickets, and I got in, oh, probably 20 feet at the most. This thing come up at me. I mean, it couldn't have been over, I'd say, 6 or 7 feet from me. I didn't even see it until it was there. And it raised up. I'm basically on my all fours in a crawl position. And I just brought my 44 up, and I started popping shells. And the first one I hit, I was just aiming right at the chest. That brownish red hair. It had hair on the face, completely covering the face. Its whole body was covered with hair. At that point, I just fired. It dropped down, started back up, I fired again. And it then kind of rocked and went backwards, and it come back up, and I fired again. I hit it 3 times with a 225 grain 44 Magnum hollow point to probably 6 to 8 feet.
Mm.
And it was down. Well, the other guys were standing guard up on top watching it, and they couldn't see nothing. They heard me firing, and they yelled if I was all right, and I said, yeah, I got it. Well, they came crawling in there and where I was at, and they seen it, so we decided we'd drag it out. And we got to looking, and all this thing had was 3 holes. And this was a female. You could tell it had breasts similar to a woman. It had a sexual organ and similar to a woman. Facial features were different than a human being. Like I say, it was covered completely in hair. So we went back in and we found the male probably, I'd say, 8-10 foot behind where she was at. He was dead. So we drug him out. We laid him out side by side. The male was probably 6 to 8 inches taller than the female, estimating the male to probably be 8 foot plus, female 7 plus. So we looked at him. We got scared because, like I said, in the male, he had sexual organs like a human. We looked at their teeth. They were not human-type teeth. I can't say that they were an ape. I can't say that they were human. They looked, they had the features of a human overall, but the details were not.
The reason why I find this encounter so fascinating is the fact that he does such a good job at describing what he's actually seen. What had happened later is they got scared. They thought, well, maybe these were humans, and they dug a hole and dumped the bodies into the hole because they were afraid of going to jail. But I find this encounter fascinating because he does such a good job at describing what he's actually seen. I mean, it's hard to listen to that story and think this is BS. I don't know. What's your guys' take on it?
It sounds very legitimate, you know, because, you know, having interviewed thousands of people all these years, you get a pretty good sense of the way somebody tells a story and how they tell it, whether they're telling the truth or not, or whether it's contrived. And this guy, you know, he kind of puts you on the edge of your seat because he's on the edge of his seat while he's telling the story. You know, it's emotion that's coming out. It's not a made up rehearsed account. And I listen to the details, and I have a witness that's got a very, very close eyewitness, or she was a very close encounter with the Sasquatch. I mean, literally inches from its face. And the description is the same. So it sounds legitimate to me.
I disagree with you guys. I don't know. He did, you know, they are Vietnam vets, according to the interviewer there. The part that I didn't like was the interviewer had said, so you saw something get up on two legs and started running and decided to shoot. He's like, right. And he's like, you guys are Vietnam vets. He's like, right. And to me, it sounds like a bunch of country boys that are out there ready to pull the trigger. I don't know if I really buy the story. I'm sorry, guys. I don't know. I think it's an entertaining story. I don't know if just because he had details and he says it looks like a human, they had the female had, you know, looked like a female with her sexual organ. I don't know. It was an entertaining story. I don't buy it, though.
Well, there are some people that will shoot at anything, though.
That's true. That is true. That is true. But then, you know, I mean, at the very end of the story, he said that they had thought that he had shot humans, and then he buried them. But then we have this video saying, oh, well, I buried these people, and I thought they were humans.
Yeah, it's sort of like, right? You know, the old Minnesota
ice
story.
You just told on yourself, right? I don't know.
Yeah, it's sort of like the old Minnesota Iceman story where, you know, that was an Air Force officer who shot this thing. There were three of them, and he shot one of them, killing it, and took off and then came back and got the body, and they kept it after they froze it for years because he wasn't sure, you know, if it was some form of human or if it was some animal. So, I mean, it sort of depends on what the person, you know, what their outlook is.
Yeah, and it's just a portion of the story, too. I mean, he goes on to talk about the noise that he heard, the growl, and they play different Bigfoot sounds, and he picks one of them out and says, that's what I heard. And, you know, he goes on to describe them, and he talks about years afterwards. You know, he doesn't live far from where this incident took place, and so not living very far from where this incident took place, I know he's concerned with what's going to happen to him now, because he knows they're in the area. He's worried about them being in the area. And this guy comes out, he doesn't even want his real name to be put out there on the air. He doesn't want to, you know, so he's not looking for the fame of shooting a Bigfoot. He's looking, I think it more or less he's trying to get it off his chest. So I don't know. I kind of buy into the story. I know it's Thanksgiving. I know we're going to do kind of a short show today, but a lot of people wanted to discuss migration habits. We've gotten so many questions about how Bigfoot migrates and how Bigfoot moves through an area. And I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that, Will.
Yeah, I can talk a little bit. I'm probably the most knowledgeable person about that because I've studied it for so many years. There are people who talk about trackways and things like that, but those are very small pieces of a much bigger picture. They don't necessarily migrate. What they're doing is they're moving through a range, and all the ranges for each, and I'm saying a group because a group occupies a range, even though they're seen most of the time as individuals. They forage and feed solitarily, but they're actually part of groups that are normally 4 to 6 individuals in a group, and they occupy ranges that can be, you know, literally hundreds of square miles. How they move throughout those ranges are different depending on the terrain and where the food is and such, but they'll move and they change their, and this goes back to the part where, you know, people often ask, why are they so hard to find? And that's a complex question. It's actually a two-part. Number one, they're staying away from threats, which we pose probably the biggest threat to them. And secondly, where the food is. So as they're moving through their range, they will change different portions of that range, what I call feeding routes, and they'll change those each time they come through an area. And it's not uncommon for a primate to do that. Gorillas do it. They'll move through their ranges and they change their little areas where they're currently feeding, you know, from 1 year to the next and so on. And they may not come back to the same area for years or ever, depending on what sort of, you know, threats are in that area to them. And so it's an emerging picture that I'm working on with this.
You know, Will, I actually have a question, and Wes, you too, and see what you know how come hunt, you know, if it's not hunting season and you go out in the woods, you see deer and you see elk and you see lots of different animals. Come hunting season, all of a sudden they all disappear. You got men out there with a gun, I understand that, and they're all hiding. But do you think, Will, that Bigfoot, part of their migration is, and you kind of touched on it, part of their migration is due to the amount of food, man being out there. And the reason why I ask that is because we don't hear with all the people that I've interviewed, people that I've talked to, you don't hear a lot of hunter stories out there about hunters seeing Bigfoot. You hear about the everyday guy that's out there just in the middle of the woods, either watching birds, taking pictures or whatever, coming on, upon a Bigfoot. So do you think that part of their migration habits could also be based on man? And when we decide when our hunting schedule is put into place, do you think that might have something to do with it?
You know, surprisingly, hunters will rarely talk about their stories. I've talked to quite a few of them over the years, and they sort of grudgingly will come out with the stories. And the Sasquatch actually is out pretty much whenever they want to be. I've talked to quite a few hunters that have encountered him and shot at him. One guy, for instance, and this was when I first moved to the Vancouver area back in the mid-80s, and my girlfriend and her kids and I were out up on the Washougal River when there was snow on the ground, playing in the snow, and I had my camera, and there was another family nearby, and the gentleman of that family walks over and he says, "Getting any good pictures?" And I sort of grinned and I said, "Well, I hope so," and then I told him what I was doing, because I had seen Sasquatch tracks up there in the snow right before that time period. And he says, "Well," he says, "I've never told anybody this story," he says, "but we were up here hunting about 17 years ago. And there were, you know, 6 or 7 of them in their camp around their fire one night, you know, talking about the day's hunt. And this enormous thing come walking up out of the darkness and stood at the edge of the firelight just staring at them. And it was, as we talked, it was the same Sasquatch that I saw in that area just a few months prior to that time. So his wife walked up and she overheard us talking about this. And he said, you know, he told me the story that it stood there for a few moments, just kind of stared at him, and then it turned around and walked away. It didn't do anything. And she says, "You never told me that story." And he says, "Well, I thought you would think I was crazy." And that's usually the way it goes with hunters. They're a little bit different outlook, I think, than a lot of people who encounter a Sasquatch, you know, that would come out and tell it. A lot of hunters won't say anything.
Yeah, well, yeah, you agree. You've talked to hunters in at the gym, remember? They were telling you about something that happened out in Susan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did. I was at the gym one evening, and I was talking to a gentleman there, and we were then working out, and we were sitting in the sauna there, and they started having a discussion about Bigfoot and about something that happened to them up in the Susan, and it completely freaked them out. It was the same type of thing, Will, that you were talking about. They were done with the hunt for the day, and they were sitting around the campfire, and they were kind of having a discussion about the day's hunt. And it was funny because it was a group of individuals that definitely, they hung out. They were at the gym working out together. They hunt together. It was some guys that were friends. And it was funny because they kind of opened up. Once one said something, then the other one would say something, and then the other one, and there was a group of four of them. And I actually thought about having them on the show at one point, but it was kind of funny. Yeah, they don't talk a lot about their day's hunt, you know, what happened and whatnot.
Yeah, you sort of have to go find hunters, you know, and then earn their trust to get them to tell you their stories if they have them.
Yeah, it's kind of like asking a guy where his fishing spot is. He'll never tell you, but he'll tell you about how many fish
exactly.
he caught.
Exactly, right. Yeah.
You know. So, yeah, I thought it was really interesting, and I do have the guy's number. Maybe I'll give him a call, and we can have him on one of these times and you know, kind of pick his brain on exactly what happened. So there's a lot of things happening here in the Pacific Northwest, and I know for sure that Wes and I, and you, Will, we've seen things, and there's other people out there that I've talked to that there's a lot of things going on, and it's interesting to hear the different stories.
Yeah, it's a lot more than most people think.
Yeah, I was trying to upload another encounter story before the show started. I didn't have enough time, though, to upload it. But it's kind of interesting when you hear some of the different encounter stories, you can kind of get a sense of behavior on what you're dealing with and
exactly.
a sense of temperament, you know, when you listen to them. Whether you believe the stories or not, you know, it's funny. They all kind of have the same ring of truth in my mind.
That's right. The more of those stories you hear, the quicker you can tell, and it's not the, you know, the Harry and Henderson's type, you know, behaviors, and it's not the, you know, going out and offering a, you know, a sweet potato or something, trying to, you know, have some sort of a friendly gesture. They're probably going to eat you.
Yeah, that's the impression you get when you listen to a lot of these encounter stories, that, you know, it's not going to be a fun encounter. It's not going to be a hand-holding type encounter with these creatures. It seems like it has a ring of truth no matter what state you're talking about. I know us being out in the Pacific Northwest, you know, we deal with a certain kind. But it seems like no matter what, I mean, the lady's talking in Louisiana, that other gentleman that had the shooting story was in Texas. I thought you'd like the red eye shine there on that, Woody, where he's talking about the biggest red eyes you'd ever seen.
Yeah, I did like that. You know, another thing that kind of came to my mind was I have a few friends that they go hunting all the time every year, and one of the spots that they do hunt is, which is up there in the Puget Sound area, and they had heard some. They didn't actually have a encounter or like actually see anything, but they heard some noises, and these guys have been hunting since they were kids. They were raised in hunting, and that's right up there in the Puget Sound on Whidbey Island, and that's not too far from us either. And I thought that was a really interesting. Will, have you heard anything out there in that area at all?
Well, I grew up in the Puget Sound area and lived there many, many years. You know, just about 30 miles south of Mount Rainier or Seattle. I'm sorry, but and hunted, you know, near Mount Rainier in those areas. And I have heard quite a few stories. People send me things, either when they're hunting or just in those areas. Yeah, I could go on for hours talking about some things I've heard up there and seen. But, yeah, there are plenty of things that go on up in that area. In fact, Pierce County is probably one of the most, or at least in the past, has been one of the most prolific areas of activity anywhere.
Yeah, it was interesting talking to my friend. He had said that they were sitting, the same type of thing. You know, all these hunters, I don't know if they all get together and decide to put the same story together, but it was the same story there on Whidbey Island, and they were camping, and they go for like 2 weeks at a time. Of course, they were talking about the day's hunt. I hate to repeat it, you know, what we've already talked about before, but all of a sudden they heard the whoops, and they heard, it was more or less the howling. And these guys, like I said, they've been hunting since they were children. Some of the best encounter. I almost take it as military. You're familiar with military, Will. And I kind of think same way as far as they've been in the woods all their life. So when they hear something that's out of the ordinary, you can probably pretty much take whatever they have to say and say it's true, you know, because they know what they're talking about. It's not their first day in the woods.
Right. And I can identify with that, you know, having, I think from about the age of 4 or 5, you know, my dad taking me out to make sure that I knew, you know, not only to keep within sight of the adults, but what I was doing out in the woods, because we lived outside of a town, out on 40 acres of pretty much a wilderness area, and you know, went hunting with them so I could learn about rifles and animals and things. They were, my parents were real big. My dad was an outdoorsman, so he was really big into my learning all that stuff as a kid. So by the time I was a teenager and was hunting with him, you know, I was pretty familiar with, in fact, I would do things that they wouldn't do. I'd, you know, wait at White River, you know, when there was 2 feet of snow on the ground to go out on the sandbars where the deer were hiding and elk were hiding. And so when I, you know, had my first encounter with Sasquatches, it totally blew my mind because I thought I knew everything that was out there.
Did you guys see that new night vision picture that was taken for the Olympic project?
Shows, I haven't seen it, but I've heard about it.
Yeah, it's supposed to show a Sasquatch in the picture, but it made me think of the, did you hear about the night vision coming to smartphones? It's an attachment you can put on your smartphone, and it creates, it's a night vision camera that, I think it's just the Android phone at this point, but it's an attachment you can put on, and as you're walking through the forest, it'll send back an actual night vision image from your smartphone as you're walking around, which is kind of a cool idea. I just, you know, night vision just doesn't, I guess, doesn't do it for me. When I see something in night vision, it's just real. I guess maybe I've just never seen a really good night vision picture, but I found it interesting that technology is starting to move forward to where we can actually use it on our smartphones now, this night vision camera attachment. But like I said, night vision doesn't do a whole lot for me. The pictures in night vision are questionable at best, I think.
You know, one thing I remember that Renee DeHinden used to tell me many, many times over the years, we talk about the Patterson film because that's, you know, he owned part of that. And he says, you know, as good as that film was for the time period, and it's still pretty good, you know, broad daylight, you know, fairly close up, he says we could have 10 pictures or films, 100 or 1,000, and people aren't going to believe it any more than they did the first one, which is true because there's always going to be, you know, people who are going to say, well, you know, that's fake or whatever. So to me, the night vision things are interesting, but it doesn't really move the issue any more forward than it already is.
I agree with you. I agree with you 100%. It just doesn't. I think it's interesting. I think it's, you know, anecdotal. I put it in the same category as, like, people's Bigfoot stories, but
yeah,
as far as
exactly.
providing any sort of evidence, it falls pretty short. But and that's not to knock people out there doing it, you know, like the Olympic project. It's cool that they got it, but it doesn't really, it's not really helping us, you know, move the subject forward and get it out in the limelight. But I didn't have a whole lot of other things for you fellas. I had those encounters. I know a lot of people don't have shows this week, and I wanted to give the audience a show. I hope everyone enjoyed the encounter stories.
Now, what do you guys think about having, I mentioned a friend of mine, Rebecca Butello. She grew up in the same area that I did at the same time. And she's the one I mentioned, and I don't tell you, Woody, but I was telling Wes that she was, this is back around the same time I had my first encounter with these two, and she lived just a couple miles from where I did. She was standing in broad daylight with her back to this big plate glass window, and her mother, she was talking to her mother, and her mother was facing her, of course, and all of a sudden she turned, I think she said she turned pale and sort of pointed, so she turned around, and here is this Sasquatch inches from the glass on the other side of her. So she was, you know, within a foot of looking at this thing in the face, and had a couple of other encounters in that area, but she's willing to come on the show if you guys think that might be interesting.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, let's do it. Yeah, let's do it. Yeah. Let's have her on. What do you think, Wes?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd love to talk to her. I'd love to hear what she has to say, and I'd love to hear what she's seen, and it'd be a great show. Be a really great show.
I thought it'd be awesome, especially with that much detail in broad daylight, you know, within a foot of its face, would be kind of cool for listeners.
Yeah, that'd be very cool.
I have one more thing before we go, and Wes, you were telling me about it, and the reason why I know about it, because you were telling me about it, was I guess there was a lady or a girl that went missing here in the area where we kind of had our encounter. Is that something that happened? Or?
Oh, yeah. I was telling Wes when we first got on the phone, a friend of mine that used to be part of my field team when I was working in that area called me yesterday morning, and he's the guy that's, you know, Sioux Indian, and he was telling me that there was a lady, and I'll have to get the information from him again. There's a campground not far from where you guys had your encounter, and she was up there going out on a spirit quest. I'm not sure if she must be Indian, but I'd have to verify that with him. But she took her pack, she went out of this campground, and totally vanished. And they did thorough searches up there. They still have her, you know, the flyers on trees and things along the roads up there. And he's been up there a couple of times, and Dan's a good tracker. And we talked about, you know, different possibilities. You know, Dan and I've hunted together and stuff, and he... We both agreed that it wouldn't be either bear or cougar up there because, you know, you'd still find parts of the backpack or whatever. And I said the only other possibility, you know, before we go off this cliff is that Skamania County is honeycombed with lava tubes. And I don't know so much about the western part, but as you go east north of Carson, there's a lot of them over there. And you can be out picking berries, blueberries. And all of a sudden, there'll be holes that'll open up 2 feet, 4 feet across. You don't see them until you're, I mean, right at the edge of them. And if somebody were to fall in something like that, those things are, you know, a lot of times 20, 30 feet across, and they're round, so you wouldn't be able to climb out of them. But I said, and he agreed with me, you know, I said, I don't think that's the case in that area because I don't really know of any, the terrain is different in that area. So we both came to the same conclusion that it could very well be Sasquatch related, that she just totally vanished.
And when did this happen, Will? Was this something
this was like in the last week or two.
In the last week or two, huh?
Yeah, this was very recent. In fact, he's going back up there in a couple days, and Dan and I used to go unarmed. He says we talked about the area, and I said yeah, that's a spooky ass area up there. And he says, yeah, I'm not going unarmed. And I said, no, don't, and don't go by yourself. So I'm gonna send you guys his contact information. And I said, you know, told him about you guys. I said, you guys should, you know, if you want to go up there together. He said there is no trace whatsoever of this woman anywhere up there.
Yeah, I'd absolutely. And I know Westville's the same way. We would, you know, send us the contact info.
Yeah, Dan,
go up
Dan's
together
good guy.
And check it out. And hopefully she's okay. But it sounds like it's, you know, if it's been a week.
Yeah,
or two,
I know at this point, geez, I mean.
It's hard to say.
It is hard to say. And I told him, I said, well, if it is Sasquatch related, these guys have gone, they've graduated to a new level, which is not uncharacteristic for Skamania County, because I have a book that was written in late 1830s, 1840s, where it's called Wanderings of an Artist by Paul Kane, and he has a small account in there where he tried to get the local Indians back then to take him towards Mount St. Helens, and they all, no matter how much he tried to bribe or anything, they all refused because they said there were these things up there that ate people, so they wanted no part of it.
Yeah, I don't blame them. We'll have to keep in contact with Dan, and maybe Wes and I can go out there with him, and we'll do a follow-up on this and see what happens later and on another show.
It might make a very interesting one.
Yeah, I think so. I think you're right.
Yeah, people don't just disappear. They don't just...
No,
like,
and we talked about that on the Clackamas River before. You know, people are vanishing over there, so... And see, if you go on Highway 14 where... You go just outside of Washougal heading east, and there's a little, it used to be just one building, maybe there's more there now, but it was called Skamania, right on the highway. It used to be just a little store and maybe a restaurant there. At that point, and then across the river, across the Columbia, I can't think of the name of the community, but locals around there for many years all say that they've seen these Sasquatches swimming the river back and forth there, which isn't that far from the Clackamas if you go south. And for these things, you know, the way they move through their ranges, it isn't that big a stretch. I mean, you're talking, you know, one or two groups in that area, depending on where the range boundaries are. So if they're eating people, which, you know, I used to think was just a rogue behavior, but I'm more inclined now to think that it's not so much rogue. It's maybe a little bit bigger practice than we think, you know, if the opportunity presents itself.
Yeah, I tend to agree with you on that. I'm starting, the more and more encounters that you hear, the more you look at the past, you look at the history, the more and more I'm starting to lean that way.
You know, that's it. You read all this history and you hear these stories and then listen to all these people out there that claim they're Bigfoot researchers, and they come up with all this bullshit. And I'm thinking, these guys know nothing about this subject because they haven't looked at all the information that's out there. They've got the entirely wrong attitude about this.
No, I tend to agree. Hopefully,
for Happy Meals.
Yeah. hopefully they find that lady. I know it's cold up there.
I was kind of upset most of yesterday thinking about it because, you know, if they're doing that, they're already aggressive from just you guys' encounter. You know, that tells me a lot about their behavior, how it's modified over the years. And, you know, and I don't know if that's pressure from human encroachment in that area, because their range used to extend a lot farther south. Well, you know, they're building, you know where the prison is out in that area? Hell, they're building homes up in that area. Now, that used to be all just wilderness up there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there's lots of homes up there. I mean, you can't even, it used to be a good hunting spot to go to, and now in fact, Will, we were talking about the prison on that side of the road. You can no longer hunt unless it's shotgun only, and on the other side is rifle. So it would be on the east side would be rifle, but on the west side where the prison is, it's shotgun only. So because there's so many homes, there's so many people out there, and, you know, we're taking over their land, and like any other animal, they're going to adapt and they're going to change. And it's kind of scary because if you think about it, Will, you've talked a lot of stories about back in the early 80s, and now you talk about the Bigfoot of today, and it seems to be that with time, they're becoming more aggressive and more aggressive and more aggressive.
Yeah, exactly. And it's, you know, when we're talking about, you know, putting a proposal together and specifying a time period, that's part of the reason. And I think 5 years is actually a very short time on any sort of a project if you're going to go out and prove the things are real or get one, is because it takes time not only to figure out how many individuals you're dealing with and how they're moving through an area, but also their behavior and how that's evolving over time. You know, you can't just go out today and then 2 years from now and do the same things because their behavior modifies. I don't know how to articulate that in writing, but I mean, I think if that's presented as part of the proposal, you know, whoever we, you know, send it to or give it to will see that and say, well, okay, and I can understand that. So I guess I'll have to figure out how to properly articulate that portion. But yeah, when you look at the history, I mean, these things are changing their behavior. They were aggressive 23 years ago when we were in the occult, but they weren't as aggressive as when you guys encountered them last year.
Yeah, so the lady that you're thinking of for next week, she's a go for next week, huh?
Yeah, she said she'll come on.
I'm sure everyone will be interested to hear that. I can't wait to hear her encounter.
I've been planning on interviewing her, you know, because of her encounters, and it was with the same Sasquatches that I saw, you know, and the state trooper tract, you know, that was just north of there, you know, that found the coyotes tore up and stuff. That was the first time, in fact, you know, back in the 70s when I went in the Army, I was in Germany in the late 70s, John Green came to my parents' house, and I told him then I had been observing, you know, from different people's stories and things, how these things were moving from Mount Rainier down the rivers and around, you know, what times of the year and everything. And I told him what I thought. And he came back and told my parents while I was in Germany that I probably knew more about the Sasquatch than anyone alive at that time, because I was exactly right. He was able to go out and verify the movement patterns. But
yeah,
you know, Green was a funny guy. He wouldn't follow up on anything.
Yeah, well, I've heard that about him. I never really understood that, but I've heard that about him, that he wouldn't.
You know, we had that encounter out on the Squally River in 76 where there were four of us that went out. And we had a group of them around us the whole night out there screaming and raising hell and all that stuff. Fortunately, they didn't eat us, but, you know, they were around us all night doing all that stuff. And one of the guys even saw one of them behind the tent. And one of the guys was partially pulled out of the tent. You know, I got a hold of Green right away after that happened. And he actually called me and came down and, you know, drove us out there. We stepped out of his van right at dusk. They started screaming and raising hell. We all kind of stood there stunned in silence for a little while listening. Then he said he had to get back home, and he never followed up. And years later, I'd go visiting him, and he'd always say, God, you know, I'm kicking myself for not bringing a recorder that night. Okay, well, what about taking people in there and actually finding these things? He, you know, that was my big disillusionment with John Green at that point.
Yeah, then he never took the initiative to kind of go go find them.
Yeah, and even Renee. I mean, Renee was great, but, you know, when the Ackhole stuff was going on, I was on the phone to him all the time. You know, whenever something happened almost daily there, I'd call him and say, Renee, you got to get here. We've got a hot one going right now. 9 months later, he decides to trundle himself down there, and, of course, they were gone at that point. So, loved Renee, but, you know, he kind of ticked me off at that point. It's like, okay, if you really want to see one, and I used to tell him, I'd say, you know, I'm going to go out and find him and bring you in and show you one.
Yeah, I know we're getting down on time. Yeah, happy Thanksgiving, guys.
Well, happy Thanksgiving to you, too, also.
Yeah, happy Thanksgiving to everyone listening, and look for next week when we talk to an eyewitness who had a face-to-face encounter with Sasquatch, eye-to-eye, face-to-face. It'd be, I can't wait to hear her story.
Yep, it'll be very interesting.